Good morning and welcome to the 23rd meeting in 2024 of Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent. And the first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take item 4 in private. Are we agreed? We're all agreed. Thank you. The next item on our agenda is to take evidence on the Housing Scotland Bill from the Housing Minister, Paul McClellan, MSP. And Mr. McClellan is joined by Scottish Government officials, Katrina McKean, who's the Deputy Director of Better Homes, Craig McGuffey, who is a solicitor, Charlotte McAfee, who is the Private Rented Housing Team Leader, and Yvette Shepherd, who's the Head of Housing Legislation and Reform Unit. And I welcome the witnesses to our meeting, and I'd like to invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Committee, and good morning. Thank you for the opportunity to set out the vision for the Housing Scotland Bill, and particularly how the measures can help us to build on our existing protections to deliver a private rented sector that works for tenants and landlords and plays a part in eradicating child poverty. I understand you intend to provide your Stage 1 report in the coming weeks, and I'm grateful for your time today. In my evidence to the Social Justice and Social Security Committee on the 27th of June and 5th September, I highlighted key measures at Parts 5 and 6 of the Bill on homelessness prevention duties, domestic abuse and on fuel poverty. Today I will focus on the actions we are taking with the other measures in Parts 1 to 4 of the Bill, such as rent control, increased eviction protection, rights for tenants to request a pet and not to be unreasonably refused, and for private tenants to make changes to a rented home. The legislation as introduced builds on the strong housing rights that already exist for people in Scotland by bringing a renewed focus on supporting tenancies to be sustained, which in turn leads to less pressure on housing supply. The package of reforms set out in the Bill are therefore focused on helping to ensure people have a safe, secure and affordable place to live. The measures in the Bill introduce changes that are positive for both tenants and responsible landlords. For example, reforming how civil damages for unlawful eviction are calculated, enabling unclaimed tenancy deposit funds to be used for the benefit of private rented sector tenants, and providing a mechanism for joint tenants to end a tenancy where there is no mutual agreement. Now, due to time constraints, I will not talk about these and other issues in the Bill in detail. However, I'm happy to answer any questions you have. I want to first of all turn to rent control. As I said in my letter to you, I remain committed to delivering a revision for a fairer, well-managed private rented sector that works in the interests of tenants and landlords and supports ongoing investment in rented housing. The Bill as introduced sets out the framework for how rent control will be delivered, and I have continued to listen to stakeholders' views on the benefits of providing more clarity on how rent control will apply. In particular, we have considered the need to set how rent increases will be capped in areas where rent controls apply. To support this, I will be bringing forward amendments at Stage 2 that will set out how the form of the rent cap will apply in rent control areas. This will provide clarity for all tenants, landlords and investors. This will build on the provisions already set out in the Bill to deliver rent controls, which will involve the designation of rent control areas on a geographically specific basis, supported by a local assessment process and carried out by local authorities. This is to ensure measures can be tailored to the prevailing rent conditions in a localised area and respond to changing circumstances. Designation of rent controls will be through affirmative regulations with a requirement for consultation ahead of the regulations being laid. The Bill already sets out that a rent control area can only be designated where it is necessary and proportionate for the purpose of protecting the social and economic interests of tenants in that area. And it is necessary and proportionate control for landlords' use of their property in that area. Furthermore, a rent control area can only be designated for a fixed time period of 5 years. Redesignation beyond that set period will require to be on the basis that further assessment shows that this is required. The Bill also allows ministers to provide for circumstances where the rent cap does not apply or where rent may be increased by more than the rent cap. On evictions, secondly, the Bill places duties on the tribunal and court to consider whether there should be a delay to the enforcement of an eviction. This action responds to concerns about the potential negative impact of the timing of the enforcement of an eviction on tenants, and that there are certain circumstances and times of the year where being evicted can be particularly problematic. The Bill sets out specific factors that the tribunal and courts may take into account when deciding whether it is reasonable to delay an enforcement. For example, due to seasonal pressures, periods of religious significance, exam periods, or where more time is required to access suitable alternative accommodation. The measures recognise that there are certain types of eviction where it would really be reasonable for the enforcement to be delayed. The bill therefore includes exemptions from the duty for certain possession grounds, such as antisocial conduct, criminal convictions, domestic abuse and vacant and abandoned properties. And on personalisation and keeping a pet, finally, the bill also introduces a statutory framework for private residential tenants to make certain changes to their home and to keep a pet. In relation to keeping a pet, which also includes social tenants, there will be a right to ask to keep a pet and not be reasonably refused. Similarly, for personalising a rented home, there will be different categories of change. Category 1 changes will not require a tenant to request permission for change. Category 2 changes must be requested but cannot be unreasonably refused by a landlord. Details of this type of changes under each category will be set out in secondary legislation and subject to further consultation. In relation to personalisation and pets, the bill sets out clear timescales for requests to make changes and regulates how disputes will be managed. For private rented sector cases, this will be through the first tier tribunal. In conclusion, convener, overall the measures in the bill are part of our vision for the rented sector in Scotland. It aims to improve affordability and strengthen tenants' rights, helping to sustain tenancies for the benefit of tenants and landlords. I continue to listen to the information shared by stakeholders and will bring forward the amendments I refer to at stage 2 once we have had the opportunity to consider in further detail how the options will take account of the interests of tenants and landlords, whilst also encouraging investment. I and my officials look forward to answering any questions members may have on these parts of the bill. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that opening statement. We have a number of questions to get through today, this morning, and we'll follow through in a similar form. I'll start with some general questions and then we're going to go on to areas around rent control, evictions, and then personalisation, then some other issues. So hopefully we'll make it in the time that we've allocated, but I'm aware that we may go over a bit of time. So I'd like to start out with a question that's kind of come to light actually in the session that we had last week. We heard concerns from witnesses, including the Chartered Institute of Housing Scotland, about the absence of a clear vision for the private rented sector in Scotland. And I'd be interested if you could briefly set out your vision for the private rented sector and how you see that this bill plays a role in delivering that vision.
Thank you, Convener. I kind of touched on my opening remarks. I think there is a number of key things, and I'll try and to keep this to the minimum as possible can. I think one is obviously to encourage growth in the sector, and I think that's incredibly important. The sector, I think, plays a very important part in the all-tenure approach that I've taken and has been obviously been discussed, I think, by previous stakeholders. So I think it's getting the balance between obviously the rent controls we touched upon, and we'll go into that, and obviously looking at the investment opportunities. So I think that's the one of the first things. I think one of the other key things as well is obviously to ensure we have the best quality homes in terms of that within the private rented sector and a flexible system for both tenants and landlords. And I think that's a difficult balance, but I think the bill achieves that in what's being proposed. I think one of the other key things as well is obviously looking at how we tackle child poverty. And again, I think that's one of the key areas, and not just child poverty, but on fuel poverty and how we tackle homelessness, for example. And I think that's a clear thing. There are other things. I think, for example, is we need to make that move towards net zero as well. So how do we help landlords? It's not part of the bill as such, but I think it's part of that ongoing discussion with landlords in terms of that. And I think one of the other things is making sure that tenants understand their rights as well as landlords. And I think, it's trying to strike the balance, and I think the bill, it does that. So that's a very quick run through, but I think we've tried to get the balance right the way through and the flexibility right the way through the bill and the measures that are being proposed.
Okay, can I just come back on the encouragement for growth? Because one of the things that Chartered Institute CIH said last week was that there isn't a sense of what size the sector needs to be. Have you been looking at that?
Yeah, and I think that's something that more broadly out with the bill, I think that's something that I'm really keen to look at. And you know, I met with the Scots Association of Landlords on a number of occasions, and I have a meeting coming up with them. And one of the key things, I think, there's got to be that tripartite agreement, that tripartite almost strategic approach. So I'm meaning that, I mean, the Scottish Government, also in terms of landlords, investors, but also in terms of local authorities. So in discussions with local authorities, it's trying to work with them to understand what does the private rented sector look like, for example, in Glasgow, what does it look like in Edinburgh, and what are the roles does it have another part to Scotland? So when I have meetings with local authorities, I'm always asking around about what's the role of the private rented sector. So I have a meeting, as I said, with John Blackwood and the Scottish Association of Landlords to talk around about what that approach looks like. So how do we get a closer relationship between government, the rented sector, and also local authorities? And again, we'll explore that and see what we can do around about that. But the PRS sector is an incredibly important part around about trying to strike the balance of housing. But it's different in every other part of Scotland, so it needs a slightly different approach. So, but yes, that's a really important part of that. So.
Okay, so yeah, so I understand that it's nuanced to different local authorities, but when you get some information around the sense of the appropriate size, I think the committee would appreciate hearing from that, because it was quite a striking bit of evidence that came through last week. I'll move on to my next question.
Yeah. So this is on
the tenants' perspective, and our panel of tenants told us about the difficulties of accessing social rented housing and of unaffordable private rents. And there's concern that the bill won't address housing affordability, as it will not affect existing rent levels, and that it won't address a fundamental problem, which is the supply of affordable housing. And again, I would be interested to hear from your perspective what ways the bill is addressing the symptoms of an unbalanced housing system.
I think there's a number of things. One I touched around about trying to get the balance between protecting rents, but also the need for investment. We need investment in various sectors there, so that comes down to supply and demand. I know we'll move on to the rent controls, but that has to strike the balance to make sure we encourage investment as well as protecting rents and keeping them to a reasonable level. And again, we'll touch more on the nuanced part of the rent controls, but I think that's important, is encouraging investment. I think more broadly than that, I think in terms of getting a more balanced rent control system in place. You know, we've had the temporary measures. Now we need to move on to a set of measures that will obviously, as I said, encourage more balanced rent increases, as well as encourage investment. I think the other thing as well, and not within the bill itself, I think is in terms of, you know, we undertook a piece of work with Ken Gibb, who was looking at affordability, and that report's just, and I think I referenced this before, and that report's just been submitted, so we're considering what that's saying. So again, that will be taken into the much broader discussions around about rent controls. But it does come down to supply and demand. You know, we need to increase the supply of housing in terms of that. So I think that's incredibly important. The bill, as I said, looks at the rent controls, but it also looks about how we can encourage investment. Now, if we encourage investment and keep the rent controls at that rate, you know, we will be able to build houses at a quicker rate as part of the all-tenure approach. I think is the important part for me.
Okay, thanks for that. And just a little bit on the, we're aware that there's a new housing national outcome, and I'd be interested to hear how the bill fits in with that and how you plan to monitor the impact of the bill so that we can judge the impact of the housing sector and on tenants' and landlords' lives.
In terms of the national outcome in housing, I think it's, before I became minister, it was something that I supported. We were obviously, this was discussed by various groups, and it's obviously recognised importance on housing. Discussions around about that and what the outcomes will actually look like is obviously still under discussion at the moment. Happy to write back to the committee on that point, because I think that's important. Obviously, on data, in terms of the rent controls, I think it's going to be an important part of looking at that and what kind of comes through on a local basis as well as national as well. And it comes back to the nuanced approach. I think in terms of then coming back to saying where we are talking about investment, what are the investment levels that are coming through in Scotland in terms of mid-market rent, build-to-rent and other forms of investment into the housing sector as well. So again, I think that's measurable in terms of that. And like any bill, you know, that has to be, we have to have a degree of how evaluating that, we have to have a degree of how effective that's been. So through rent controls, through the rent increases, but also through the levels of investment, I think is important in terms of that. But we will write back to the committee on the national outcome with more details around about that.
Great, thanks very much for that. Now, we're now going to move on to the rent section, and I'm going to bring in Pam Gosselin. And Pam, just to say, if you take your first question, and then there's a few people that want to come in with supplementaries, and then you can come in with your second question.
Okay. Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister, and good morning, your supporting official staff. In previous sessions, witnesses raised their concerns that the housing bill could shrink the market and lead to further reduction in homes available. Witnesses stated that the importance of giving confidence to investors in the build-to-rent market and believe that change is required on the face of the bill. Does the Scottish Government accept these are valid concerns? And if so, what changes does it believe are necessary on the face of the bill?
I have engaged with stakeholders extensively over the period of time that the bill's been brought out. And before then, obviously, I'd engaged with that. I think the key thing, I think, for me was when I took over this side of the bill, if you like, from Mr. Harvey at the time, obviously reviewed what had been proposed previously. And the key thing, I think, for me was setting out a bill that, one, still protected people where they needed to protect in terms of rent increases. I think that was the main point of that. And I think indicated that, and we've indicated that in PFG just last week. But the other thing, I think, for me is that need for investment. Now, whether that be in mid-market rent or build-to-rent, I think is incredibly important. So we are been engaging with stakeholders extensively on that, and we'll continue to do so. So yes, we do need that investment. There's no doubt we need that investment to build it. Government funding, as we know, whether it's in the UK or in Scotland, is extremely tight at the moment. So and you know that this you know institutional investment won't replace the need for government funding, because that still remains, and hopefully we'll expand and grow in that particular time. But we do need investment into the sector, whether that's mid-market rent or build-to-rent. And I think we kind of indicated it in the PFG last week when we talked around about the MMR and the commitment to MMR funding and so on. So that has been through discussions with that. I also set up a housing investment task force around about 9 months ago, which was bringing together investors, bringing together banks, bringing together local authorities, likes of SNB, SFT, to say around about how can we get more money into the sector. Now, rent controls have obviously been part of these discussions, but there's other ways we can try and get money into the sector in terms of that. So I'm really committed to making sure we get investment into the sector. So, yeah, I do take the point that investors have said, but hopefully, you know, what we achieve through the bill, that will allow investment to come into Scotland. There's already been investment, but we need to get more to help, because lots of developments, for example, need the all-tenure approach. So sometimes that would be local government. There'd obviously be funding from local authorities and RSLs, for example. But we need institutional investment to do that as well. So what I'm hoping to achieve through the bill and what we're proposing through rent controls is striking that balance.
Do you have a supplementary there?
I do. Yes. Yeah. It's just basically around the huge issue driving up rents. We all know that simply don't have enough homes here. And has the Scottish Government taken any action to better understand the resource constraints associated with especially tradespeople in the private rented sector?
I think it's not just in the private rented sector. I think it's much broader. There was a study out by the CITB probably 6 to 9 months ago now, which kind of broke Scotland into 10 areas. And the 10 areas kind of identified what was the resource in terms of workforce, what was the resource in terms of companies that operated in the areas, what was the resource in terms of colleges. So I met with Graham Day and still continue to meet with Graham Day around about that, because in terms of how do we fund the colleges and towards construction. So I think there's been discussions around about that. I think one of the other discussions I've had with the CIH as well was around about the sector itself. So how do you professionalise the sector? How do we make sure that the sector is as qualified as possible? What can we do to try and work on that? I asked the CIH for a paper to talk around about that, how do we professionalise that. That's just recently been received, and we're working with the CIH on terms of how do we expand the qualifications, what else is needing to be done in the sector to make sure that we've got enough qualified people and attract people into housing. Because again, it's not a sector traditionally which has attracted people in, but it's a sector that I think has great opportunities in terms of that. So we're working with CIH, we're working with CITB, and working with Graham Day in terms of how we can maximise that. There have been issues, as we know, through Brexit, which has reduced the workforce, and we've seen that. And again, you know, how do we make sure we try and get people into the construction sector? I know there's discussions, and it's been raised with the UK government in terms of visas, for example, for the construction sector. And it's not just affecting housing. When we look at the growth in renewables, for example, I know, and having spoken to colleagues in that sector, there's a real demand for construction work in terms of that. So it's a whole number of solutions that we're looking at to try and make sure that the sector's up to the level it needs in terms of recruitment and in terms of future training. The average age, I think, for people in the construction sector is near enough 60. You know, we can't go on like that because, you know, in terms of, if you look at the demographics, you know, we've basically run out of people. So it's a challenge, but there's different ways we're approaching that.
Can I just ask, Minister, you said there was a task force just in your first question, the setup. Can I ask, is that task force working? Because obviously you've told me that investors and you know, there are people, banks, different people on this task force giving you guidance, but we've just heard evidence, obviously, over the weeks in here that there is a big issue with a certainty in investment, that the fact people don't want to invest in that market anymore. So I just want to know, is this task force working? That, because we're obviously getting people in here giving evidence that are clearly saying that there is an issue.
And one of the key things I think I mentioned at the start of the bill was to making sure we give that. Because one of the key things in speaking to investors, they want clarity. They want clarity. It's long-term patient capital that normally tends to invest in this, so they want clarity over a certain period of time. So the discussions I've had, obviously, that's the message it's came through. So the approach, the two-pronged approach, one was obviously trying to get the House Investment Task Force, where there are members of the investment community that are part of these discussions, and also trying to give the clarity through the rent controls. So one of the key things the House Investment Task Force was looking at barriers. So it's not just on rent controls, it's looking at other areas, for example, use of guarantees and other areas as well in terms of that. So that's looking at a much broader range of measures. It's going to produce a report and with recommendations, and that will be driven by the Housing Investment Task Force itself. So again, and we talked about the MMR initiative that was followed last week at PFG. That kind of came out of discussions with the Housing Investment Task Force. So we're looking at different ways, different models that we can try and do that. So the MMR commitment that was given last week kind of came from the Housing Investment Task Force. So we're looking at different ways in terms of that as well, that hopefully will come out in the short term in terms of recommendations that they're making themselves. But we need to give clarity around about rent controls. There's no doubt about that.
When will that report come out?
I think we were looking at the first quarter of next year. It was the target that the committee, that the task force has looked at themselves. And again, happy to write to the committee on that particular point when it comes out. But the minutes are also online, so it can be looked at as well. So.
Okay, thank you. Just to come back on the announcements that were made by the First Minister on amendments that will seek to attract more investment, I think we'd be interested to understand what the government's plans are for those amendments to this part of the bill, and also if those amendments are, if one of the proposals is potentially inflation-linked increases, that, you know, that's maybe what you're exploring, because I think one of the issues is how can attracting more investment come about without allowing more profit to be extracted from tenants and thus continuing to make housing ever unaffordable. And I appreciate you've got quite a balancing act here, but I think it's quite an important issue.
No, and you're right. I mean, that's one of the things that's been considered. You mentioned about inflation linked. I think what I'd mentioned previously was around about the discussions we're having for example, living rent with investors and so on, about trying to strike that balance. And it is, I mean, it's a tough ask, but you know, I still think we can achieve it in terms of, you know, what's been considered, to make sure we have that protection for tenants, but also encouraging investment into that. So I can't go into detail because we're still considering and still discussing with and still have meetings planned with stakeholders in terms of that. And I think that's one of the key things, I think, is trying to strike that balance. And I mentioned that right at the start, and it's about trying to give that flexibility as well. So, you know, as I said, it's giving that clarity to investors, as Ms. Goswell said, but also making sure we protect people where they need to be protected, and that's where that local approach can also come in terms of that. And I think that's incredibly important around about what's the data and what's the, you know, what are the local authorities' views, for example, what are local residents' views on terms of that. And I think that's trying to get that balance. Because again, if you look at Scotland in terms of where some of the rent increases, it's not the same in different parts of Scotland, as we know. Now, that's a much broader discussion around about the supply and demand and how do we encourage more house building in Edinburgh and Glasgow. And I have these discussions with Edinburgh and Glasgow on a regular basis around about what can we do to try and encourage that. So the rent controls and the bill itself is part of it, but there's much broader discussions going on in terms of that as well, in terms of how do we bring strategic sites forward. And we mentioned about the Housing Investment Task Force. One of the key areas of work is how do we bring strategic sites forward at a quicker pace. So again, it's looking at in terms of that. Now, that then needs a mix of investment. It needs a mix from local government funding and government funding. Also, the likes of where did the role does SNB play and SFT play, for example. So it's a much broader discussion than that. But I think in terms of what we're looking at, it's all about trying to strike the balance, and that's hopefully when the amendments come forward, we'll demonstrate that.
Okay, I mean, I think that if new amendments come, we'll potentially be doing a bit more evidence taking.
Yeah, and I was going to mention that anyway, that of course we'd be happy to do that.
Yeah, Mark, did you have a supplementary here?
Yeah, thanks, Kevin. I think most people would accept that essentially the rent control elements of this legislation, you know, are the flagship part of the bill. And I wonder if the government had considered, given that, you know, this is our last evidence session, we are going to be producing a stage one report with recommendations, essentially in the dark, without any knowledge of what the final proposals for the flagship element of this housing bill will be, whether the government had given any consideration to withdrawing the legislation and committing to reconsult on whatever the final proposals are, give the committee the chance to consult on that and actually have the substantive recommendations and conclusions within a relevant stage one report, because you know, we're going to be debating in the dark.
I think the answer to withdrawn bill is no, because I think there's a number of reasons for that, and then I'll get into more of the detail. I think one is in terms of we do need that clarity for tenants in terms of what the rent increases look like. I think secondly, Ms Goswell mentioned about the investment opportunities, so investors need clarity in terms of that. I think in terms of where we are just now, it was a framework bill, but I think it was to give that flexibility. That flexibility, one, was looking at in terms of local areas and what's required in terms of that. Two, what's the rent control formula going to be itself, I think, is an important part in terms of that. And I think one of the key things is also discussions with stakeholders. And I appreciate the point you're making about the committee, and I'm happy to come back to the committee when these amendments come forward. And I think, obviously, discussing with stakeholders to get that balance is an important part. I think within the rent controls themselves, if they are proposed, and again, I think this is coming back to the areas, there is if a local authority proposes and would like to go down that route for rent controls, it has to go to consultation as well. So I think it gives consultation to the people who live in the area as well in terms of that. And I think that's incredibly important because, yes, the principle of rent controls are there, but the rent control measures that are proposed in Edinburgh will be different from Glasgow, will be different from other parts of Scotland. So there is that consultation that's built into the bill as well in terms of if there's a rent control to be introduced. It's all about trying to strike the right balance. I totally take the point you're taking about committee, but we need to move on in terms of giving that clarity to both tenants and investors and trying to strike that balance. And trying to get that balance of, you know, as I said, you know, giving that certainty about keeping people in the PRS sector. You know, and then when talking about investors, you may be talking about landlords who have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 properties. I think that's important as well, that we recognise the PRS sector as a really important part, but also the investment sector, the MMR sector, but also the tenants. So I appreciate the point you're saying, but happy to come back to committee when the amendments are public, again, to be held to account on that. That's what I'm here for. But I think it gives us that flexibility. It's all about trying to get that balance and move us on at a time when we need that little bit more certainty.
Minister, could you give us a timeline on that work that you're doing, just so we have an understanding of, like, if we publish our report, how much time is there between our report coming out and that information coming forward?
Now, I understand, and correct me if I'm wrong, your report's due the end of October-y time?
Yeah, tentatively at this point, I'll say.
I would think it would be around about that time, not too far off, okay. Around about that time. But again, happy to come back to committee when these amendments come out and have that discussion and take that further with you.
Thank you. Emma Roddick, would you like to come in?
Sorry,
convener as well. And I think one of the key things, and Mr Griffin knows this, I mean, I'll be having discussions and I think we've got a note out to Mr Griffin and Mr Briggs and others about speaking about the bill then, because one of the key things, I think, for me when we talked about the cladding bill was making sure that it was as collaborative as possible. And I really want to see that approach as well. So I will be talking to Mr Griffin, talking to Mr Briggs, and other party spokespeople around about that as well, around about, OK, where do you see this kind of going? Because the bill ultimately has to get through Parliament as well. So, you know, and again, this is where it's discussing and trying to be as collaborative as possible. So happy to meet with Mr Griffin and Mr Briggs. And I think there's either letters out, there's meetings planned already within the next few weeks to discuss this. So again, that it's open to any member who wants to discuss the bill with me. Happy to discuss that with them.
Thanks very much. That's very much appreciated. Emma.
Thank you, Convener. Part one of the bill gives ministers power to designate part or all of a local authority a rent control area based on the reports that councils have to submit. The Minister's already mentioned Edinburgh and Glasgow. Are there other areas that the government has indications at this stage that it expects to be making such a direction? And will the tests be the same for all local authority areas?
In terms of, I mean, I mentioned Edinburgh and Glasgow, so when you look at some of the rent increases, Edinburgh and Glasgow have been areas that have been under pressure. I think some of that's down to supply and demand and much more broader measures. And I talked around about, for example, how do we look at, how do we bring strategic sites forward in Edinburgh? How do we bring strategic sites forward in Glasgow? So we've had discussions with Edinburgh and Glasgow. I asked Edinburgh City Region, for example, to bring me a report and say there's about eight strategic sites. What's required to bring these forward in a time? Because the quicker we can increase supply, it's basically to come next, you know, it's the supply and demand. Glasgow is similar. They're going to be taking some similar approach and looking at the city region kind of broader approach as well in terms of that. I think when you look at some of the rent increases in different parts of Scotland, I think it can depend. You know, you can sometimes see rent increases are quite low. And I visited other parts of Scotland, for example, in Inverclyde, where they have the opposite problem. So that local approach is really important in terms of that. So I'm not going out and saying it needs to be Edinburgh, Glasgow, so it's not government targeting these. I think I've gave them as an example because these are the areas that have obviously been identified where there's been large rent increases. I think obviously we'd sit and consult with both COSLA and the local authorities in terms of what that kind of looks like, and obviously look at the data behind that to make sure that, you know, that if, you know, what's behind that, to make sure if that is taken forward. And it has to be in consultation with the local authorities and on the data, and we need to be doing a little bit more about data. And I know that's something, you know, that I've mentioned before. So how do we work with local authorities? I talked, for example, around about the size of the PRS sector in Edinburgh and Glasgow. I'd like to see closer collaboration between local authorities, PRS sector and government in terms of what does that sector look like, what's got its opportunity to grow, what's its role in terms of tackling homelessness, in terms of that, how do we incentivise people to come back into the PRS sector? So it's much broader than that. And I think in terms of then the rent controls themselves, there is that need then to consult with the local community in terms of what that actually looks like. So, but it's given that flexibility within the system in terms of what's required in Edinburgh, what's required in Glasgow. In terms of that. Now, it's set out for a period of time, but it also gives ability, if we find that data changes over a period of time, you know, that doesn't mean that the rent controls stay in there. So it gives that flexibility again to say, right, okay, if there's any changes in the economy or whatever, then we've got the flexibility to remove these at that time as well. So it's doing that. But Edinburgh and Glasgow, I gave us examples because we've seen where the largest rent increases have been.
So if those same rent increases were seen in other areas, the government would be seeking to implement rent control areas in those as well, if they were the same as what's been seen in...
I think that would obviously need to be set out, and you know, that's a much broader situation. You know, what because, again, if you're talking about rent increases in Edinburgh and Glasgow, what are the specifics behind that as well? So I think we've talked about, for example, around about the opportunities about the Freeport up and also around about the renewables hubs in terms of that, because you're going to get construction workers going into these areas. How will that increase rent controls? Now, that itself, how will that increase rents? Now, that in itself might be short-term, but we need to make sure we're taking cognizance of that going ahead as well. If there's workers being attracted to the Freeport area, for example, and Highland Council estimated that was 25,000, you know, we've got to be making sure we're building houses at a level that meets that demand as well. So we're having discussions with Highland Council around about that. We're having discussions around about renewables hubs. How can we look at the opportunities for, first of all, accommodating construction workers, but what's the legacy housing opportunities behind that as well? So it's taken cognizance of other local, impacts that they might have at that. So again, it's that flexibility allows us to look at in different parts in Scotland and maybe the reasons behind that in terms of that. But it's got to be backed up by data.
Okay, so just finally, local communities being mentioned a few times now as a consultee. In the bill, it's the local authorities and representatives of tenants and landlords. Is that a change in direction to consult with the wider community?
I'll maybe bring in a bit on that, the specifics of that. I think the key thing is that, you know, of course, the local authority will come forward with their what they think it is. We'll obviously look at that as well. In terms of that broader consultation, Yvette, I don't know if you want to touch just a wee bit on that.
I think it remains to be seen how it would be consulted, but in the process as it's being envisaged, then The assessments will be carried out. They will come to the ministers. The ministers will assess the information from local authorities. They will carry out assessment based on guidance and information from Scottish ministers to how the assessment will be carried out. And we're working in partnership with local authorities to determine what that assessment process will look like. That's part of the work that's going on to support the detailed development that will allow for implementation. Ministers will assess this information. They will make the decisions in discussion with local authorities, and potentially where rent control areas are going to be taken forward, there's a requirement to consult. So there are various ways you could do that. You could consult individually on each local authority area in that specific area. There's a potential that we could consult nationally. So put out a single consultation in an open way that allows anyone to comment on where ministers are intending to take forward rent control. So there is a little bit of detail to think through in terms of implementation. They're just different approaches. Do it singly by each area locally, or to do it nationally with a list of all of the areas where local authority assessment has indicated rent control should come into place, to allow anyone to commit to make a comment that can be taken into account in the final decision making.
Can I clarify something?
Okay, clarify that. We really need to move on.
It sounds like the language being used is quite different at this point in terms of councils coming forward with proposals rather than ministers making decisions based on the reports that all local authorities have to bring forward. Is this moving more towards councils requesting a rent control area, and how will that be different to the likes of rent pressure zones, which no council managed to bring forward?
No, the legislation as it's set out at the moment places a new mandatory duty on local authorities that they don't currently have. So there will be a duty for local authorities to carry out an assessment of conditions in relation to rent in their local areas that will run on a cyclical 5-yearly basis, so that we have that long-term commitment to assessing conditions in relation to rent to establish whether or not rent controls would be an appropriate control to be brought in. So it will run on a cyclical basis. Local authorities will have the duty to assess, mm-hmm. so to carry out that process in accordance with whatever guidance ministers have issued, and then to make a recommendation based on the outcome of the assessment. That recommendation and the assessment will be passed to ministers. Ministers are the decision maker. So they will look at that information, review it, understand what the outcome of the assessment is, and look at the recommendation from local authorities and make the final decision, subject to consultation, and then obviously going through Parliament. It's an affirmative regulation that will go through the Parliament for the final decision.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm going to come back to Pam, your second question.
Thank you, Convener. In previous sessions, we've heard from witnesses that there is a lack of robust data, which could leave councils liable to legal action should they decide to enforce a rent control area. In fact, data on the private rent sector is so poor that we cannot tell whether it is reliably growing or shrinking. Witnesses are sceptical that the robust data set that would be in place by 2026. Do you share these concerns? And if so, what action is the Scottish Government taking to improve data on the private rental sector? I do have a bit about the national side, but I'll let you answer that right now.
I think there is recognition of that, and I touched on a data point just earlier on in terms of that. And I think the new deal for tenants kind of touched on the data. And I think there's a couple of things, I think, for me. One, I think, is in terms of the relationship that needs to be, and I'll touch on the specifics, but one is the relationship between local authorities, government, and the PRS sector itself. I think that's really important in terms of how do we strengthen that, how do we make sure there's a closer relationship at a local housing strategy level, and investment level, and so on, at a planning level. So what does that kind of look like? And I think that kind of gives you the kind of overarching relationship I'd like to see develop, because I think that's really important, and I've discussed that with local authorities and Scottish Association of Landlords, and we've got a meeting to come up to discuss that in a wee bit more detail, which I think is really important in terms of that. There is already work that's kind of underway in terms of looking at data, because it needs to be there in terms of how do we determine rent controls for local areas in the future, and that needs to be there, because if we don't have data, we'll be making assumptions based on data that might not be accurate. So there's discussions with local authorities at that time in terms of that, and I think that's the key thing, is how do you develop that data that's been needed. But again, we're discussing that in detail with local authorities. And again, I don't know if Yvette wants to touch on that in more detail, but there are, you know, I have this discussion with councillor colleagues and also officials at that particular time, and that's a really key part. But in terms of the actual logistics about how it works, I don't know if Yvette wants to add anything else on that, but there are ongoing discussions about that.
I think there's two things to reflect on within the bill as it stands at the moment. There is a power for local authorities to require data from landlords in relation to the information that would be required to support local authorities to carry out their assessment. So local authorities will have the power to approach landlords for that information that they need to support their assessment. And there is a provision for local authorities to apply to the first-tier tribunal for a penalty, in short, from landlords who don't provide that data. So as it stands, in terms of the kind of carrying out the detailed assessment process, that is available to local authorities and they would be able to access the data that they would require on tenancies and rent levels to support their assessment. There is a separate, as Minister has alluded to, there is an acceptance that improved data in relation to the private sector, rented sector more generally, would be helpful in terms of rent control and more broadly. And our New Deal for Tenants consultation did reflect on that. And work is underway at the moment in terms of a data collection project to try to look at the best way to achieve this. There's a lot of different options that could come into play in terms of collecting data and how best to deliver that in a way that's robust, that gets the data that's verifiable, that supports rent control development, and also that is cost-effective and feasible in a practical sense to deliver. So there is a project going on looking at that to decide how in the future we could improve data collection more generally. So those two things are working in parallel. As I mentioned earlier, we also have a local authority working group in relation to rent control. So we are talking with that group about this issue, about how the actual assessment process will be designated. We're looking at a two-stage process that will have a screening exercise that can go forward on the basis of data that's already available. So we do collect data on the private rented sector through Rent Service Scotland. And then a more detailed part of the process that would look in more detail that then local authorities could collect data themselves to support.
Thank you. Just on the local authority working group, you've probably heard we've had obviously the witnesses in here, and COSLA spoke about having a national approach and making sure that basically having that collective approach so that there is no legal challenges coming through. But also what was said in here from witnesses was resources. Very important. Is that something the Minister is looking at in his bill? Because already councils are very, budgets are cut, that they are looking to collect this data. This is more burden put on them. So where does the bill address, basically, or where would you address the fact that these councils, local authorities, have got the right resources in place and the right support mechanisms?
Yeah, I think there's a number of things. One is obviously having the discussions. I know there's discussions that officials and talking in about in the vet kind of highlight that. I think the second thing obviously is discussing with local authorities when I talk to them about the resource issue. So there is that issue has been raised, and I think that's important. I think the financial memorandum kind of sets out initially in terms of what the estimated costs would be on that. I think as we develop the bill, the financial memorandum needs to demonstrate that in terms of the resources that are required. Now, the discussions we're having with local authorities, just don't talk around about what the data collection is about. It's around about the resource that's required to do that. So again, that would come through an updated financial memorandum. So the discussions we're having is obviously looking at the resource for local authorities, because the point you mentioned is incredibly important. We can put more additional pressures on local authorities without that. So the discussions also include what's the resource that's required to deliver the data that we're looking for. So that's been raised by local authorities. And again, we're asking them just to be more specific around about that. The initial discussions around about estimates. What we'll do.
And what's your thoughts on the national approach that they mentioned?
I think Yvette's kind of touching that. I think one of the key things I think for me is in looking at the discussions with local authorities and the SAL, for example, Scottish Association of Landlords, is to discuss that, you know, because again they've got data in terms of what does that kind of look like. And for me it's really important that we have that data to say, right, okay, both on a local basis, because that determines what's the size of the sector in Edinburgh, Glasgow or other local authorities, but nationally, how do we develop the PRS sector and what role does it play in Scotland? So there's a need for that, but that's hopefully I'll be discussing that with local authorities and SAL when we have that discussion relatively shortly.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. And I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin with a few questions.
Thanks, Governor. I want to come back to the MMR, Minister, and it's good to hear the government recognise the importance of mid-market rent properties. You know, they make up a crucial part of the affordable housing supply programme. I think we've heard evidence from witnesses who are concerned that any legislative changes, any application of rent control to the MMR sector could impact on supply, and that's something that, you know, neither of us would want. So just to ask, given the commitments and programme for government and today, whether the government have given any consideration to exempting mid-market rent properties from the rent control proposals.
I can't go into the specifics. I think in terms of any exemptions, I think one of the key things I think that's key to mention, I think the bill does give us the power to specify types of properties or other circumstances where rent increases wouldn't apply. So again, I think that's the key thing in terms of that. I can't go out and speak specifically on MMR and what that looks like. And, you know, obviously I think when discussions come forward in terms of some of the amendments, that will become clear. I think we demonstrated that the value of MMR in terms of the ability it does to bring in additional capital. And I think when we mentioned last week that 100 million would probably look at basing bringing an additional capital of about 500 million based on some of the investments that are already there. Now, that kind of came through discussions about the Housing Investment Task Force and colleagues in the housing sector were talking about, so that there's a recognition of the importance. You probably heard SFHA obviously talked about the importance of where they see MMR in terms of that. So obviously we're listening to what they're saying along with a range of other stakeholders. I think one of the key things, I think for me, and you'll know this as well, Mr Griffin, is in terms of it's that all-tenure approach, you know, so it's not just in terms of social housing. You'll need that mix of MMR and different parts of Scotland as well. Now, MMR is easier in some parts of Scotland than it is than others, and then you obviously get the private investment coming in. So I've visited a number of developments, as I'm sure you have as well, in terms of where there is a mix of social housing, MMR housing, and private development going on in terms of that as well. You know, so I want to see that flexibility within the Scottish housing market, because I think that's a real example to try and bring forward projects that might not be viable on their own, but with MMR or private development or social housing, it works. And I think that's about trying to achieve the balance in that. So, you know, I think as we do bring forward amendments and whatever, you know, I think, you know, well, obviously, yeah, I think there's a recognition in terms of the evidence that's kind of been taken in terms of that as well. But we're listening to all stakeholders, and again, it's about striking that right balance. But again, happy to discuss that in more detail once that becomes available.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Miles.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to officials. And I think I would express my frustration, like Mark Griffin has, not being able to look at this detail. I've been arguing for some time that the mid-market rent sector, especially in social rented sector, should be removed from the bill. And I hope it is. That mystery isn't useful for us doing our work. So I hope when we do meet, we can get a real clarification on that. I met a number of developments during the summer where they've just withdrawn from pretty large-scale development here in Edinburgh, and it's desperately needed. Some evidence has suggested that landlords are leaving and are planning to leave the private rented sector. And from what I've heard, there does seem a completely change in tone from the minister since we've seen changes in government structure. So I just wondered, in terms of looking at the bill, what de-risking of that for landlords has taken place to try to make sure that we have that balance and we don't see a loss of more private rented sector properties, especially here in the capital where that has been coming through.
I'll talk on the specifics of the bill in a wee second. And again, I think what's really important is recognition of the PRS sector. First of all, and I'll touch on MMR and BTR in a wee second. In terms of the PRS sector, I think that's incredibly important. I think there's discussions we've had with Edinburgh and Glasgow, and I suppose it's kind of fair to say that both know the need to probably work a wee bit closer with the PRS sector, and that's in a strategic kind of approach. So what is the role of the PRS sector in Edinburgh? What is the role of the PRS sector in Glasgow and other parts of Scotland? And I'd like to see more deeper discussions around about that and maybe being in part of local housing strategies, and I think for me that would be something I would encourage, and I know we've written out to local authorities on that. So I think that's kind of given, one, the recognition of the PRS sector. Two, how do we make sure the PRS sector grows? And in terms of the rent control bill itself, I think that needs to be recognised in terms of what we're doing. Let's try to strike that balance in terms of what's being proposed, but also trying to bring in investment. Now, that's investment in a might be somebody who, a landlord at the moment who owns one property, maybe goes and gets another, or somebody that's got 5, 10 and maybe looks to double that, that kind of stuff. So that's really important in terms of that. And I think that's you know, in discussions I've had with the SAL, that's something I've said to them in terms of that. I want to see people come back in the sector. The latest data has shown the figures it has slightly increased. Now, and anecdotally, talking to anybody in Glasgow, what they've kind of found out is that they've probably seen the more single landlords, single owner property landlords, probably selling up, but it's going to property owners, landlords who probably got a bigger portfolio, 5, 10, 15 kind of stuff. So the number of landlords is probably decreasing. The number of properties in the sector is slightly increasing at the moment. Now, there's a slight lag, but that's the data that's kind of coming through on that. But I think that, so, you know, that's I suppose, is recognising that. I think there's a couple of other things as well. The bill, I think, in terms of the rent controls, I think we're kind of saying if a local authority says it's, you know, we've got the requirement, it comes to ministers and requirements, think of the requirement, you know, there's also the opportunity to review that at that particular time. So if there's a change in circumstance, for example, you know, these can be revoked or whatever in terms of, it kind of gives that, you know, it's not rent controls and they're there for 5 years and they can't move. So there's an opportunity to discuss that as well. So for that flexibility. So I think it's in terms of, one, can we give that clarity through the rent controls? And if they are on a local authority, then there is that flexibility, if circumstances change, to change that. But then we've got to end the balance around about how do we get into the MMR and BTR. In terms of MMR, housing associations obviously recognise that as a really important part of it. Now, if you're talking about Glasgow, for example, because it's a non-stock authority, then RSLs have a really important part in how they develop that. So again, we've listened to Glasgow in terms of what they're saying, and we'll consider that. Same with Edinburgh, you know, there's a number of housing, but it's not just in terms of RSLs, it's in terms of what that broader, how does it deliver broader. Now, there's that wider discussion, and again, you know, when we're talking about a local housing allowance, and where does that kind of sit as well, because that obviously has a part to play in that. So again, sure. Discussions with the UK government on previously and also now as well in terms of what does the role of LHA kind of come in near it as well, because I think that's a really important part of that also. And as I said, in terms of BTR, it's all around about trying to encourage, one, we've got churn in properties in Edinburgh and Glasgow, and that's turning around. But secondly, it's recognising the role of BTR as well in terms of that, not just in terms of housing, because I think that's important, it increases supply, but in terms of the investment that brings into Scotland, and also in terms of construction jobs and GBA that brings into Scotland as well. So it's trying to look at that. But in terms of the discussions with stakeholders about BTR, MMR, and individual tenants, such as through the Scottish Association of Landlords, these are discussions I've kind of picked up and had discussions about the importance of all that. But again, on the other side, you know, we've got to make sure that the rent controls are there protecting people who need the rent controls in place. Now, the challenge for me with the bill is to strike that right balance. I think we're moving in the right direction, and I appreciate the point you're saying around about obviously being a framework bill. Happy to come back, as I said, to the convener to discuss the amendments and any changes in detail when that kind of comes through. But for me, it's really important to get the right balance. It's a tough ask. In terms of a complex market, it's not one size fits all, but that's what we're hoping to achieve. But happy to come back to committee at the appropriate stage to discuss these.
Yeah. Thank you for that. And I've got a few more questions with regards to evictions, but I think
we'll stick with the rent section. And we'll come back to you.
Yeah. Great.
Thanks. Emma, would you like to come back in?
Yeah. Some private landlords are concerned that a rent control area rent increases between certain tenancies would be restricted. Obviously, we know that is where a lot of rent increases happen. Could you speak to how that might come across in the bill, and particularly how it could affect rents within rural areas?
I think that's obviously something that's been raised in terms of that. And obviously, you're on interest in housing in rural areas. I think that's incredibly important. Again, I think it kind of comes back to, and these are, you know, obviously part of ongoing discussions that we're having with local authorities, and it's not just Edinburgh and Glasgow. I'm having discussions with Highland, other local authorities. In any local authority I go, you know, I'll speak about the PRS sector and where that kind of comes in. The bill's always raised in terms of that as well, and I think it comes back to I think it comes back to some of the issues around about local circumstances in terms of what that looks like. It's not something that's been raised hugely in rural communities. It's more around about supply and demand. And in terms of the PRF sector, and happy to have that discussion because obviously you'll be closer and have more regular discussions in terms of that. But it's more around about what's the role of the PRF sector, and it's different in rural communities. Sometimes it plays a larger role in terms of that. So I think it's taking the circumstances locally in terms of what that looks like. I'll bring a vet in terms of, you know, I've maybe had discussions with rural authorities in terms of that. It's not something. I think it's been hugely raised, but it's an issue. I think that we need to obviously be very aware of. But I think it's that local flexibility, I think, in terms of that. But Vera, I don't know if you've anything else you want to add on that point.
In terms of how the measures are laid out in the bill at the current time, then the restrictions in relation to increasing rent, so the cap, would apply both within a tenancy and between tenancies as well. And that's a kind of integral part of making sure that actually the purpose of the rent control measures, which are to stabilise rent levels over a period of time that rent control is in force, it's integral to delivering that purpose that the controls apply both within and between tenancies. Other than that, rents are controlled for those in an existing tenancy, but they will increase, and it has the potential to make it difficult for people to move to a new tenancy if they're in an affordable tenancy, but moving will see a large increase in that, then that can make moving on unaffordable for tenants. So that's how the bill is structured at the moment. We do understand that some landlord stakeholders have a concern about that. They'd rather have the capacity to increase rents to whatever level they feel is appropriate between tenancies. But as I say, it's integral to the functioning of the purpose of the measures in the bill that isn't part of the process. In terms of just kind of reflecting on local authority views, we're engaging in our local authority stakeholder group with about 18 or 19 different local authorities, and then we have about another 9 who are corresponding with us. So we've got a fairly good spread of local authorities that are actually engaging on the process that we're going through in terms of working in partnership in relation to rent control and how it could be implemented. So we are helpful hearing lots of different views from different local authorities, including those in more rural areas, and how they think this could function for their areas.
I think the other thing as well, obviously, one of the key things is obviously these regulations need to be reviewed on a regular basis. And again, I think that's important, and also that, you know, they don't need to be in place longer than required. So I think it's trying to give that flexibility as well in terms of that. So it's not here's the 5 years and it's definitely for the 5 years. It gives that flexibility to do that. And as I said, you know, there might be circumstances where we are talking about the free port, for example, or anything else that's kind of going on which might impact on the housing market. And, you know, I visited Shetland and Orkney and talked around about the impact of renewable development. And it's great to have the economic development, but if you're getting an influx of construction workers or longer-term workers for a certain period of time, it does distort the market to a certain point. Now, we need to try and tackle that when we're talking about the need for temporary accommodation. And we're having discussions with authorities around about that and have a round table with local authorities talking about that. But it's in terms that, but if we don't get that right, or the local authority doesn't get right, there's going to impact on rent, because, again, it's down to supply and demand. If you're getting 2,000 or 3,000 construction workers moving in an area and there's a lack of accommodation, that's going to impact on that. So that we need to do... There's that broader strategic discussion we need to have, but in terms of where the rent controls kind of sit, they shouldn't be in place any longer than they need to be, and they're reviewed on a regular basis as well. But again, as Yvette said, we're speaking to rural communities, local authorities about that now, and trying to obviously look at any issues that might come up further down the line.
So the idea would be to put in rent controls in areas like Freeport?
No. I'm using that as a suggestion, because again, we need to look at that broader. I'm talking about how a market might be distorted for a period of time. So we need to make sure that we are developing housing as the workers come over that period of time. If we don't get that balance, I'm not saying that would be the case, but I'm saying that might distort a housing market in terms of that. So I'm not suggesting local authorities need to do that or go down that route, but we need to be aware of local circumstances and how that might change. Because when we talk to Shetland and Orkney, for example, they've seen increases. And rents go up by a large amount in terms of that, because there wasn't enough accommodation at that particular point.
Yeah.
Strategically, we need to get ahead of that to make sure there's enough temporary accommodation, and working with local authorities. And also, if the Freeport is estimated 25,000 jobs, so we need to be developing housing in terms of that to make sure that we're meeting the demand, because again, it's supply and demand. So again, we're in discussions with Highland and with also with local authorities, house builders, and you'll know we had a round table last year, for example, where we got house builders round the table with the developers, the Freeport developers, and saying, like, okay, how do we develop this in line? So that's an example of how a market might be distorted. But that's not saying that we'd be for rent controls or anything like that at all. That's up to where the local circumstances, and obviously we'd have to be backed up by data.
Okay. Emma, just before you go on to your next question, Mark has a supplementary, and I'm going to have to ask if we can kind of like corral it back into kind of the bill focus. I mean, the detail is really good to get into it, but we do have a lot of questions to get through. If I can bring Mark in, very brief supplementary, and then Emma, I'll come back to you.
Yeah, it's just on the rent increase between tenancy. I wonder if the government have any concerns about whether that might inhibit investment and improving property standards, particularly when we're talking about net zero and improving energy efficiency, whether there's any way for landlords who make significant investment in improving their property, are then able to look at having a rent that reflects the increased standard of the property?
I know where Mr Griffin's trying to get to, and I can totally understand that in terms of, because he's probably had feedback from investors, for example, in terms of that. We have to recognise that, and then I said, you know, and get a framework in terms of the bill principles, which encourages investment. And again, that's something, obviously, when we look at amendments and whatever around about that, that's something, obviously, we have to take cognizance of kind of going forward. But happy to discuss that in more detail as well. But, yeah, you'll know the feedback that's come back from the sector that we've been speaking to you as well, I'm sure. So, but, yeah, that's something that we have to try and strike the balance on. So.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much, Emma.
Thank you, Convener. Part 1, Section 15 of the Bill demonstrates that local authorities can request certain information from landlords to support the reports that they're creating. Would the Minister be open to requiring landlords to provide that information as standard?
That's something I think it's still under consideration. I think, I don't know if Yvette wants to add anything to that and some of the discussions that she's had, but that's something that's still under consideration.
There is, the measures in the bill are framed around local authorities landlords being required to provide that information to local authorities, and there is a potential for local authorities to apply to the First Year Tribunal for a penalty if a landlord doesn't comply with the requirement. So there is a little bit of a kind of closing out that loop to get that information, and as I reflected on earlier, there is an ongoing project looking at improving private rented sector data overall, and there are a number of ways that could be achieved, and that's what's been worked through at the moment, looking at robust, verifiable, feasible and practicable ways of collecting that data that could include landlords providing a standard additional information. But there is quite a lot of work in that. It needs to be robust, it needs to be cost effective, and it needs to work for landlords.
Okay, thank you. Can I ask the Minister why the onus is on tenants to challenge rent increases? We had a panel of tenants who proposed an alternative system whereby landlords should have to apply to a third party like Rent Service Scotland to increase their rent levels at their property, and that would place the onus on the landlords to ensure compliance and improve that data collection and relieve the pressure on local authorities to collect the data. What are his views on that?
I think there's a number of things. One, I think in terms of the general principles, and I think I kind of touched on that, was in trying to improve on renters' tenants' rights. I think that's one of the key thing, and I think that's something that in terms of awareness raising, we need to try and tackle that. And we've spoken to tenants groups around about that. I think that's an important. I think that the bill also sets out information that landlords have got to include in terms of advertisements for rental properties, and I think there's a measure set in the bill as well, which is proposing that they modify the landlord's existing duty to provide specified information to the tenant at that particular time. So it's a bit of both that's working the landlords to make sure that they're making tenants as well. But there is that general awareness raising that we need to pick up. And again, we're talking about that with tenants groups in terms of what that kind of looks like. And I meet tenants groups on a regular basis, both locally and nationally. So that issue has been kind of raised. And that's more broad, not just around about rent controls, but in terms of that, but much broader in terms of renters' rights and what can we do to try and support them in terms of and making them aware of that, because as you, the point that you rightly recognise, not everybody, you know, who's a tenant has are aware of their rights, but that's something more generally we need to continue to work with them on.
Absolutely, agree, but tenants wouldn't have to be so aware of their rights to challenge rent increases if landlords had to justify it in the first place. So should that onus be more on the landlord to justify it?
I think it's trying to strike that, again, in speaking to landlords, it's trying to strike that balance as well. I think what's being proposed does give an additional onus on landlords to do that. But we have to do that in terms of the raising awareness of what's there for tenants as well. And as I said, I think when it talked about landlords, there's the specific point about they have to give a I think there's specified information to a tenant at the start of the tenancy in a rent control area at that specific time. So there is an onus on landlords to make sure that they do that in terms of that. So again, but we'll continue to discuss that with tenants in terms of that. But it's trying to strike that balance.
So the government's not open to moving the onus on to landlords?
I think it's about that balance. What does that balance kind of look like? I think there's a duty for both to do that. I think we need to make sure that in terms of the tenants' rights that we're picking up, and there's that raising awareness. I think there's obviously that with the landlord as well. So, and again, there's that whole discussion and debate around about, you know, if you're getting people into the sector and around about the regulation for example, maybe with single property landlords in terms of that. So it's trying to strike the balance in terms of that. But I'm confident, you know, in terms of the balance, that might move slightly. But what's been proposed in the bill, obviously, was kind of set out as the initial position. We'll continue to discuss with other stakeholders and obviously what committee feedback would be on terms of that as well, and what that would actually look like before it becomes into law.
Thanks.
Okay. Thanks very much. I just want to point out that it would be very helpful if we can. So a number of times this morning, you've indicated conversations with colleagues outside of this room. But what would be very helpful is if we can have, you know, this is public scrutiny, and if we can respect that, and it would be good if we can have information and answers shared here for the whole of the committee's benefit. Thank you. I'm going to bring in.
Just on that point, obviously, that's discussions I have as you know, in day-to-day role is that, not just specifically on the bill. But, yeah, I appreciate the point.
Certainly, I agree that you have to meet with different party representatives, but we want to get the information because there are people watching this who want to understand what you're trying to do with the bill.
Yeah.
Thank you. Willie, brief supplementary.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Minister. I just have a request to clarify a point that was discussed earlier on the application of rent controls. Is it the case that a rent control area can only come about if a local council recommends that it should come about to you, because you have the power to designate rent control areas? Is it likely, possible or otherwise, that you could proceed to declare rent control areas without the local authority actually seeking them?
I think there's two ways to kind of look at this. One is in terms of one is obviously there would have to be the data that would back that up. I think secondly, in terms of, you know, it's a right of the minister to look at that, but it's also the right of a minister as well to, you know, to say in terms of would I impose rent controls in one area, for example. But there's also an ability for, if a local authority comes in and says we want to look at rent controls, I also have the ability to say, or the minister at the time can say, no, we don't agree with that. So it's not just a case that it would come in. It also gives the flexibility for government to look at that as well, and the minister to look at that as well and say, no, we don't think there's a case for rent controls at that particular time. So it's got to be looked as in terms of that balance. But the key thing in this, it's got to be backed up by data. And you know, there'll be discussions. It's not something that would happen overnight. It'd have to be something that would have to go out for consultation and broader. But it gives the minister the right to say, you know, in terms of bringing in rent control or not. And I think that's a key thing. You know, what's the local circumstances at that particular time? So it may be a local authority wants to do it. Minister might not agree, and we would have to give the reasons for doing that. But it gives ability both ways to look at that.
Yeah, but what I mean is, though, if a council doesn't make such a recommendation for a rent control area, does it go any further?
I'll bring in, my understanding is the minister or at a particular time would still have the ability to do that if they wish to do so. But again, I mean, I think the circumstance of that would be highly unlikely. But as I said, you know, you're talking at the situation just now. We don't know where circumstances might change in a period of time. But I don't know if Yvette wants to add anything else on that. But
as it's constructed at the moment, the local authorities are responsible for carrying out the assessment and making a recommendation. So those are two specific duties that are placed on local authorities. ministers will require to review that recommendation, but also to review that evidence that comes forward in the assessment. And there will be guidance to local authorities as to how the assessment should be carried out. This is what stakeholders and the local authorities themselves are telling us, is that they would like to make sure that the approach is consistent, where it's really clear that how they should be considering information, considering evidence to help them to reach the conclusion. Any decision by the minister will be reliant on that data and evidence and information that is coming forward from the local authority. So it will be a case of reviewing that evidence. Where ministers feel that local authority haven't adhered to the guidance or have not carried out the assessment in the way that it was intended, they have got the power in the bill to ask the local authority to do further work or consider further evidence, which is a potential option where ministers could look for more assessment and further information to be taken into consideration if they do consider that the recommendation from the local authority isn't really balanced in the terms of the information that they've brought forward in the assessment.
Okay, I think that's clear.
I'm just going to, okay. Emma's indicated it's such an important topic, I'm going to allow one more question from Emma before we move on to evictions and tribunal and awareness of rights. So, Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to clarify that if the local authority carries out an assessment and the data suggests that rent increases are too high in a particular area, but the council is not minded to recommend a rent control area, is the minister prepared to direct one anyway?
Can you just ask that? Just so I've got it clear in my mind again.
The data suggests that rent controls are required, but the council is not minded to recommend that a control area be defined within their local authority. Is the minister prepared to implement one?
Yeah, again, I think Yvette talked around about the circumstances that there would be an option. I think first of all, and Yvette can touch on that, if we didn't think the data was sufficient, you know, that we could go back. As I think, as Yvette said, that I think if that's still the case when it comes back, in terms of that, that'd be something that you'd have to take in an individual circumstance. But I think the minister does have the ability to do that. But again, I think there's a number of points before you even get there in terms of, is the data they're providing, is it, I think at the time, do we think is it sufficiently backing up what they're proposing one way or another? And I think that's where it takes into the local consideration that broader. But I don't know if you want to add anything on that other than what was added before. But again, there's that procedure in terms of looking at the data that's kind of coming forward. So do we think the data they've collected is sufficient and sufficiently supports what they're proposing? Now, that might be the other way about, or might be the other way about, you know, in terms of that, they might come forward and say, like, we don't recommend it, or we do recommend it. So there's different circumstances in terms of that. But I don't know if you anything else you want to add in other than you added just there before.
Not particularly. The evidence base for designation will come from the local authorities. So if that evidence base that's coming forward in the assessments indicates that it would be the right approach to take rent control area, then I think it would be about understanding why the local authority feels that in this particular instance that's not the right course of action. But if the evidence is there to support it, then that's obviously the key consideration for ministers in making a decision.
Thank you.
Thanks. That was a worthwhile getting that detail there. Back to Willie with evictions and so forth.
Thanks very much again, Convener. And into the evictions territory, Paul, some of the witnesses at our committee previously were suggesting to us and to yourselves that we need to and should review some of the grounds for eviction, particularly on levels of proof that are needed to evict a tenant, as well as some requests to improve tenants' and landlords' awareness of their various rights and so on. Have you had a chance to reflect on that, and would you be minded to strengthen that part of the bill so that we are clearer about grounds for eviction and the rights that tenants have and so on?
I think mentioned before, it's part of a wider strategy in deal for new tenants, and I think one of the key things from that is probably learning from the coronavirus and how, you know, that kind of talked about. I think we are committed to a review on that, and I'll maybe ask, I suppose, I think it'd be Katrina to maybe come in, Charlotte, on that one. The timing's still to be kind of confirmed, but I think that's important that we learn the lessons from that, and I think that was a challenge we didn't expect at the time, obviously, with COVID and had to deal with it, at that particular time. But I'll ask Charlotte to come in on that particular point. But it's something we need to consider, Mr. Coffey, in terms of that, because, you know, as part of the refresh, if you like, and looking at the bill, it's an important part in terms of that. We knew at that time, you know, when the emergency legislation was brought in, you know, there was license to learn in terms of that. But I'll bring Charlotte on that particular point. So.
So there is an outstanding commitment to review the repossession grounds. I think that was a commitment that was made that we knew with the introduction of the 18 grounds in the 2016 Act, that you know, as part of our monitoring of how it was operating, that was a key thing. Obviously, since then, we've had a few changes. We've had the strengthening through the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Act, where all the grounds have moved from being, some of the grounds from mandatory to everything being discretionary, bringing it into line with the social rental sector. So there are a number of aspects that this review would now look at, including sort of the grounds for proof and misuse of some of the grounds potentially. So that is something that we have remained committed to. The timing of it needs to be confirmed, however.
OK, thank you for that. Turning to the tribunal, Paul, there was evidence given to the committee about concerns about how the tribunal operated, particularly in relation to the time it took to deliberate and so on. But there was also a suggestion that we needed an ethics component to consideration of these processes, that was singularly missing from what the work of the tribunal did. And it's really to ask the government, had you thought of that as an aspect to widen and strengthen the work of the tribunal?
Yeah. And the tribunal, obviously, really important, and I'll touch on that in a second. In terms of the ethics, again, that would be something, you know, considering. I'll maybe bring Charlotte in to talk around about that. I think one of the key things, one, obviously, the Courts and Tribunal Service sits alone in terms of that, and it sits as its own body, and I think that's one key thing. Now, obviously, we have discussions around about the case numbers, staffing numbers and costs in terms of that. I think that's an ongoing discussion in terms of that. I think we have raised the concerns around about the time it's been taken, but obviously that as a separate body, I think that's and it's its own judicial decision maker, if you like, so we can't interfere in that. It's all about trying to strike the right balance in terms of that. And I suppose, again, it kind of sits on its own, but Charlotte, I don't know if you want to touch about the ethics point, whether that's been discussed or not. But again, there are discussions, as you appreciate, Mr. Coffey, but it sits separately. But obviously, there's discussions with officials have with the Tribunal Service. But Charlotte, do you want to add anything on that one?
I think as the tribunal operates, obviously the ethics and how they consider reasonableness is all part and parcel of the judicial process. So it is something that I think we don't comment on those arrangements that they have in place. I'm sure that's a key aspect of determining any reasonableness is the operation of the tribunal. I don't know if Craig wanted to say anything around how reasonableness might be considered, but that is a very key part of the role of the tribunal is to look at the various parties and ensure that their members who are considering the case act appropriately.
Just before Craig comes in, I think, Mr. Coffey, one of the key things is I think the tribunal itself offers... It's a less adversarial kind of approach, and by its very nature, you know, these discussions can be tricky, as you can appreciate, but it's trying to, one, it's recognising the work that the tribunal does in terms of that, and it tries to promote a less adversarial kind of approach in what can be really difficult discussions. But I'll bring Craig in just in terms of the point that Charlotte made there.
Yeah, I think judicial discretion is something that we don't want to interfere with. The court's the best place to consider matters of reasonableness, far better than government would be. So there's nothing in the bill, obviously, to interfere with that. The separation of powers means that the judiciary are best place to deal with the consideration of individual circumstances of a case, whereas we can set out parameters for that, the question of reasonableness or not for us to direct the committee, the tribunal on.
We heard a case, Paul, last week, I think it was, where a tenant can still be evicted if their landlord defaults on their mortgage payments. And that kind of fell into this space a little bit, whether that was right and proper. Legally, it probably is, but it kind of fell into this space of whether that's an ethical thing to do, to throw a person out because a landlord defaults on their mortgage. So that's why I think these questions were raised, and we were looking for some kind of clarification for the government as to whether they would intend to try and incorporate issues like that within the eviction process and grounds itself.
I'll bring Charlotte in a wee second in terms of that. Happy to take, you know, pick that up if there's further detail on that, Mr. Coffey. There was a specific case or whatever, but I don't know if Charlotte wants to come in just on that specific point, because we do hear that obviously happening occasionally.
I think these are complex cases, and there are duties on lenders and as well in terms of how they would recover property. I think it all comes down to this question of reasonableness, and that would all take into account all of the circumstances of the case, including the default and in determining whether it was reasonable. They're not mandatory grounds anymore. In the past, I think that was one of the mandatory grounds. I would need to confirm, but you know, now it is and it's discretionary, so the tribunal could decide that it isn't reasonable in the circumstances of that case for that tenant to be evicted. So I think, you know, the current parameters do allow for these cases and to be considered on their own merits and for a decision to be taken.
Okay, last query from me, convener. It was really about representation at the tribunal. We heard that people are rarely accompanied or represented at the tribunal. They basically attend themselves, and it's often a very difficult and challenging experience for them, and they lack the experience perhaps to be able to do it. So there was a suggestion put to the committee again to be directed to the government as to whether you think that is an issue and whether we need to support tenants a little bit more at tribunal and offer them some kind of support service to allow them to make their case more correctly, perhaps.
And again, I'll bring Charlotte in a second. And the tribunal service, I think, does allow that for both either tenants or landlords to have that representation in there. Now, whether that's a friend, whether it's a family member, whether that's third sector, because I know I've been aware of cases where, like the shelter, for example, I've been in part of that. But Charlotte, I don't know if you want to touch on that. And again, this might come back to part of the discussions around about, you know, tenants' rights. Tenants, you know, are they aware of what that's available to them? And again, that's part of the discussion. I think Ms. Roddick kind of talked around about, you know, do we need to make sure that tenants are aware of the rights to do that? And again, I don't know if Charlotte wants to touch on that, but I think, correct me if I'm wrong, they do have that ability to do that now. Now, whether enough tenants who go to the tribunal are aware of that, that's something I think we'd be considering. How can we support that? But I think that right's already available just now.
Ability to pay for it, perhaps, is maybe what the
Well, I think, for
was.
Example, I mean, again, in the experiences I've had as a councillor and so on, when it goes to that, it tends to be like a shelter or other third sector organisations that primarily support them. In terms of, I think if it was a court requirement, it would have to be an incredibly complex one to do that. And I always find that shelter have that level of expertise to help people in nearly all the circumstances that kind of come up.
So there is the ability for different types of representation for the tribunal. For example, you know, a landlord tenant could bring in a friend, a third-party advocacy person within the tribunal. It could also be a legal member, a solicitor. So it's the acknowledgement that there are serious cases where legal representation would be necessary, and the same legal aid that is available elsewhere is available to those people in the tribunal system who need it.
Okay. Thank you for that. Thanks, convener.
Great, thanks. I just want to note that we're fast approaching 11:30, which was our originally agreed time. And I think we've got quite a few questions other members want to get in. So I'd like to just see if that's okay for us to run over maybe 20 minutes.
Yeah, fine by me.
Maybe a bit longer, depends on how long your answers are.
I'll try and keep them short.
And how long our questions are as well. I have to say, maybe we've got long questions here. But can I bring in Miles Briggs?
Convener, I'll try to be concise. We're looking at some of the personalisation issues, and you will have seen the evidence given by the Dogs Trust, and trying to look towards how we flip this round. I don't know in terms of what thoughts the Minister has had since we took that evidence, but looking towards making it for a landlord, say, rather than tenants to apply, and that having to go through a tribunal process.
On more generally and personalisation, and I met the Dogs Trust previously before I was a minister, and that was an issue that was raised by them to talk about that, knowing there was a housing bill coming up, but not not known in. And as I said, they did mention that in terms of how helpful that can be with people who maybe are, in, you know, maybe more elderly and that's their companion, or people who can't get out of home because of illness and so on. And again, that was raised at that particular time. I said that was probably two and a bit years ago, so before I was a minister. And I think that's really important. I think in terms of discussing with landlords, because I've visited local association of landlords, for example, and talked around about that. I think one of the key things is more the procedure. What's mm-hmm. the actual procedure that needs to be in place? And again, it depends on if it's pets, you know, is it a small wee chihuahua or is it a Great Dane? And I'm maybe, you know, exaggerating in terms of that. But again, it's got to be relevant to the size of the property. I think it's still on, I think for me, it's still on the onus of the tenant to look at that. But it's trying to be as flexible as possible. I think obviously we'll look at that in more detail in terms of more detailed regulations that kind of come forward about what that actually looks like. But in terms of the landlords that you kind of spoke to, it is all around about just making sure they're aware of the procedure and they have the ability within reasonableness to say, look, no, you can't have a Great Dane in a one-bedroom flat, for example, yep. And doing that. But recognising the importance of people having pets as companions, as I said, and I think that's an important part. It's about strike the balance in terms of dogs and other animals. So I think that's a key thing.
And that shift almost towards a presumption in favour instead. But
because I think in terms of reasonableness, then you've got to have a landlord who would have to say, look, on the grounds of, because of, in terms of that. So I think there is that balance, but I think that would be fleshed out more in terms of the detailed regulations. But you're right, it's about striking that balance. But the landlord would have to give a reasonable grounds for saying no.
Yeah, there's also a significant part of the bill with regards to home adaptations, and I think currently the bill requires tenants to wait 6 months before applying to make modifications to their homes. I know there's been specific concerns raised with regards to older citizens and people with disabilities and what that could mean, and just wondered if you could clarify whether the needs, for example, of older people will be considered when looking towards that. And specifically, I think some of the cross-portfolio concerns which we've had with regards to people getting home, people getting out of hospital, what that looks like, and speeding that up, whether or not that's been taken into account as well. Because often people will be stuck in hospital, and that was one of the reasons we're given around delayed discharge.
And you're right, I think more broadly that's an issue in adaptations, and I think one is trying to make sure that local authorities are aware of the adaptations that are required, probably more proactively, rather than trying to deal with adaptations that, you know, that almost... And there will be cases, for example, where it's just somebody comes to hospital and needs that. I think there's guidance that tries to encourage landlords to look at that and to try and move as quickly as possible. And I wouldn't see a position where the landlord saying no unless there was real... technical issues, for example, behind any if it was heavy changes in adaptation lifting gear, for example, in terms of that. So support and guidance does look around about trying to provide that as quick as we possibly can. And again, I think that's really important in terms of kind of going that forward. Small changes, I think, you know, I kind of touched on it in terms of some of the changes, either category one or category two changes. It depends, you know, if it's a couple of handrails, I wouldn't imagine that would be an issue. If it was a lifting gear going in, for example, I think that would obviously be, you know, does that impact on the property and so on? And you would imagine discussions at an early stage. Yep. You know, there'd be technical reasons for all that kind of stuff. But there is support and guidance to try and encourage landlords to be as flexible as possible within that period of time, particularly around about the issues that you raise in terms of that. And I'm sure most landlords would be sympathetic around about that. But again, it would depend on the level of adaptation.
Yeah. And just finally, I know there's been significant research done by University of Glasgow and Marie Curie with regards to terminal ill people having to move, and statistics showed 27,600 people in Scotland had to move because of a result of their experience of dying, death or bereavement. And just wondered how that was being seen within the bill. Marie Curie had given evidence to the committee to include a full exemption of terminally ill people from eviction. And just wondered where government were on that with any potential amendments you're now drafting.
I think in terms of that, Marie Curie, I think at the recent discussions, I've mentioned that in terms of what that would look like. So I would expect to get some correspondence if it's not coming around about that also. And I think that would be something that we could look at I've also had discussions with MND and Marie Curie on terms of getting a process in place to deal with people around about adaptations, because you know sometimes that you know, it's life-threatening, and it's particularly around about some cases with Marie Curie, with cancer or MND, it can happen very quickly. So it's a real importance around about trying to get a structure in place to make sure that's dealt with. So we've been speaking to LACHO, for example, in terms of that, and local authorities, in terms of having a process in place that would make sure that these are prioritised in terms of that. Now, that's through either through a local authority, but if it's PRS sector, again, I think having a process in place around about that as soon as possible for people who are, you know, terminally ill, I think would be something that we would consider. I fully expect that both MND and Marie Curie would send something, and obviously we'd look at that sympathetically, because it's trying to get people in as comfortable a position as they can. And both, I said, MND and Marie Curie have raised this in previous discussions I've had, but not received anything yet, as far as I'm aware.
We have had discussions already with Marie Curie in relation to those, and it may be helpful to say that there are already existing processes for both the social and the private rented sector that enable succession. It's not blanket, and again, I think that the tribunal, all of the grounds being discretionary, that gives a significant protection to people to ensure that the right decision is taken in all the circumstances of the case.
That's helpful. I think as the bill progresses, it'd be useful to see, I'm sure there'll be cross-party amendments around some of this, where the legal team within government can assist with those as well.
And I think you're right, Mr Briggs, in terms of looking at it legally, but I think in terms of the point you're trying to make, of course, that would be looked at sympathetically. And there's already been discussions more broadly around about the process, about adaptations and succession, I think, as Charlotte's mentioned.
Yep. Thanks. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks very much, Miles. I'm going to bring in... Gordon, you want to come in and sup on this one?
No.
Okay, just moving on to other issues. Come on in. Okay.
Thanks very much. Good morning, Minister, and good morning to the rest of the panel. I wanted to ask you about part four of the bill, in particularly relation to unclaimed tenancy deposits. You said in your opening remarks you wanted to use it for the benefit of private sector tenants. Could you be a bit more specific in what you mean by that and how much the cost would be of providing this additional service?
I think I'll get onto that in a wee second. I think that one of the key things was recognising the importance of that. I mean, I've visited, I think, the organisation itself, Rent Deposit Scotland, in terms of what they kind of do and the work that they undertake, and I was impressed by, obviously, how they try and return the deposits as best that they can, and it's a substantial amount in terms of that, and I think that's one of the key things that they kind of discussed. I think in terms of making sure that we've got the information to hand, I think is incredibly important, because I think one of the issues that they said was sometimes there was one telephone number or one email address. Somebody changes their email address and all of a sudden you can't get a hold of somebody, and people will get to their tenancy, move on, and then forget they've got...
I was going to ask you about that. There seems to have been a substantial increase in the amount of... deposits that haven't been claimed. I mean, if you look at March 21, it was 3.3 million. Yep. March 24, it's 5.4 million. The big increase seemed to have happened between March and September of 23. Do we know why there was that big increase at that time?
I know there was issues, for example, around about COVID at that particular time when I visited them a year and a bit ago. I know there was issues around about COVID and people moving in and moving out reasonably quickly because of that period of time to try and find accommodation. I'm not too sure on that one. Shall, if you want to,
I think we can
else?
Look at that specifically, and we can write to you to look at the figures. We would need to speak to the schemes as well to see what those. I think there has been a lot of the unclaimed deposits. One of the things that the review of tenancy deposit schemes showed was it was to do with international students, and so that there are sort of different factors that come into play in terms of why a deposit remains unclaimed.
Having looked at the numbers for the three schemes, my deposits over that three-year period, their increase in unclaimed deposits increased by 16%. Safe deposits increased by 69%. And these are figures provided by the Scottish Association of Landlords. And Letting Protection Service, their unreturned deposits increased by nearly 300%. Do they all operate on the same basis? And do they all look after the same demographic of individuals?
So it's not the same demographic, my understanding, but again, we can write and confirm some of this. My understanding is that some of them are more heavily based on student market versus others. So I think there's elements at work there that feed into it. But yes, they all need to comply with the same regulatory framework, the same key performance indicators. Mm-hmm. Yes, structurally they are the same. They do have obviously different systems, some of which have expanded to include the ability to gather additional alternative contact details, which is helping with the return. That's one of the things that we are looking, not within this, using existing regulatory powers to look at changing the regulations to increase the requirements to have alternative contact details so that all of the schemes are subject to the same requirements. But some have independently shifted to address that.
Okay. So there was a survey done back in 2017, I think it only looked at one of the deposit schemes, and it said in terms of international students, it was some of them forget, so some think they won't get it back, and some thought it was too inconvenient. What can we do to address this? Because this is 7 years down the line, and the amount of money that's lying unclaimed has probably more than doubled since 2017.
You're right. The information that tenants have is really, really key. I think the changes in the bill mean that, as part of the implementation, we have another opportunity to be very clear with tenants that what would happen if you didn't reclaim a deposit. And I think just knowing that deposits sitting unclaimed will help raise that awareness. We do have a substantial number of unclaimed deposits that are now historically quite old. Yeah. So I think for those ones, there is a challenge because we can't contact them, but there is the opportunity through the general public awareness raising around the implementation of the measures that some of those may come forward again to reclaim. So there's a number of opportunities in terms of our implementation plans and communication strategy that I think can support some movement there.
And do you think we have the balance right between the powers of the landlord and the tenant in terms of reclaiming the deposit?
I think there's an onus, obviously, in terms of the landlord to take as much information at the start of the process, and I think that that's key, because if you've got one email address and they change email address, it becomes very difficult in terms of that if they've got one mobile number. So it's trying to get as many and I think the onus is on the landlord to get as much information as they possibly can as well. It's the same, obviously there's a responsibility on the tenant as well to try and provide as much information as possible, but I think that's got to be very clear at the start of the process. There's a substantial amount of money that's sitting there at the moment, so it demonstrates, I think as you just mentioned, Mr McDonald, about the increases, they're quite substantial increases. I know part of that probably, I would imagine, would be down to COVID, but it's not just that. But, we can't have a situation where, if you change it, an email address, then and you forget, and international students obviously. So how we, again, probably is with universities in terms of that to make sure, or do we have information from universities? I know there's GDPR kind of issues around about that, but we've got to try and maximise the information that we have on a tenant, because there's a substantial amount of money that's sitting there that could be used. Now, that money can be used for a specific. I think the bill kind of touches on and about. And it's restricted in terms of that. How can we? And I think the key examples, it's an information assistance on private residents, tenants on their rights, services or facilities that promote or support the interests of private tenants, and preventing private tenants from becoming homeless, so that the funds can be used. But it has to be specifically talking about how do we support tenants in terms of that. But it's 5 years, I think. Okay. It's seen as an unclaimed deposit at that particular time. But yeah, we need to decrease that amount of money. And if we can't, or reduce it, but the money that's still left there, we need to make sure it's protecting tenants' rights and supporting what they do as well. So.
Okay, thanks so much.
Thanks, Gordon. And we've got a few more questions. We'll see if I can rattle through them. First, I just want to say that certainly I have a personal experience of great landlords in the private renter sector. And what I'm about to ask is not a reflection on them, but last week, Tony Kane talked about how the private rented sector attracts a significant element of poor landlordism and also attracts criminal activity. And that was in response to a question that I was asking about the idea of landlords having to put their EPC certificates, the gas safety checks, and also the electrical inspection condition reports in a public-facing setting, so online somewhere. So uploading it so that someone who's about to go into an agreement with a landlord would see that there's that level of accountability in a way from a landlord. And I'd be interested to hear what your thoughts are on including that as an amendment in the bill.
Happy to discuss that in more detail. I think in terms of, in principle, I think, you know, that I think something we'd obviously consider. I think in terms of discussions with association landlords, they obviously talk about unscrupulous landlords, and you were talking about a small amount of people here, but how do we make sure that that doesn't impact on that? And you're right, the EPC is a really important part in how that's looked at and provided. And I think that comes back to, they recognise that as well. So the association itself has to make sure that they're limiting landlords such as that being in place. I think there's the carrot and leg of the stick would be including that in the legislation. But I don't know in terms of, I don't know if it's Charlotte or Christina would like to talk on that. But again, happy to talk about that, you know, in terms of that in more detail, convener, if that was the case. But I don't know if anybody, Charlotte or Christina, want to talk on that.
I can come in briefly, yes. Minister. Yep. It's not something that we've given consideration to in the context of this bill, but it is something that is an ongoing consideration in terms of how well the landlord registration scheme is running, the types of information that's provided through that approach, and certainly something that we're interested in the context of potential new requirements for private rented sector landlords in light of our proposals for heat in buildings and moving towards a decarbonised position, also thinking about fuel poverty. So certainly these are things that are in the mix in terms of policy considerations, but not something at this stage that we've considered for this bill.
Thanks. Can you pick that up offline or contact me on that particular point?
Okay, thanks very much. And then another question is around seasonal worker accommodation, which is currently unregulated, and I see you are kind of recognise that issue. So I'm aware of seasonal workers living in overcrowded caravans, sometimes six people, each paying about £300 a month, and in some cases poor conditions. And I wonder if there's scope in this bill to protect these workers who are also renters?
It's slightly more complex than, you know, whether does it fit in this bill, and the responsibility at the moment Kenny sits under. And again, if it's agricultural or seasonal workers, there's a line in terms of where that Kenny sits. And I'll touch on that in a wee second. In terms of seasonal agricultural workers, Marie Gujon and myself have a meeting with Richard Leonard to come up to discuss that point, and he's raised that along with others at that particular point. So we have a meeting coming up very soon to discuss that. I think in terms of more broadly, it's trying to identify key workers, you know, because again, visited various places where that becomes an issue, particularly during the summer time, if it's tourism and so on. So does that become an issue for local authorities looking at key worker strategies? And again, kind of encourage local authorities to look at that, to take a strategic approach in terms of that. So that's kind of one way to look at it as well. And again, it comes back, and it's not so much the seasonal workers, but around about the accommodation workers, for example, about construction. So that issue Kenny falls in there, but on seasonal workers, on agricultural, particularly about agricultural, Marie Gujan and I have a meeting with Richard Leonard coming up. In terms of the key workers and more broader seasonal workers, it would be the local authority we would encourage to look at strategically what they need to do and come forward with any discussions or proposals on that. And we've had some discussions, we've had a number of round tables with accommodation hotels and other organisations to talk around about that, about what we need to do around about that. But it's an issue that needs to be touched upon, because the reports that were out, I think, last week, you know, we can't have people staying in accommodation like that.
Good. I'm glad to hear there's some cross-portfolio working there. Okay, moving on to the financial memorandum. COSLA expressed concerns about the financial memorandum and that has some elements, including homelessness prevention duties and rent control aspects, that are significantly underestimated. And a coalition of private rented housing providers has also criticised the government's response to the Finance Committee, arguing that the minister's response has misrepresented our legitimate concerns and dismissed the substantial impact of the proposed legislation. And so I'd be interested to hear how you can ensure assure the committee that your approach to developing the financial memorandum has been thorough, appropriate and whether further assessments will be needed in light of any proposed government amendments.
I think there's a number of things on, obviously when I spoke to the Social Justice Committee in terms of homelessness prevention, we contacted local authorities to ask about that and they gave their best estimate at that particular time, and obviously we touched on that. There are obviously details, discussions with local authorities, with colleagues talking around about what does it actually look like in the implementation and when is it phased in and what does it look like. So I think that's the really important part, and the onus on that is not to put additional resource implications on local authorities, and I think it was Ms. Gosell mentioned that particular point. I think that was incredibly important. The discussions that we're having in terms of the local authorities again are touching on that point. What's additional resources that would be required, one for the data collection, in terms of what would that look like going forward as well. So there are ongoing discussions. Stage one, the financial memorandum was always an estimate at this stage. There will be an updated financial memorandum at the end of stage two in terms of that. So, I mean, I think the safe thing to say is there are ongoing discussions. We have to make sure that the resource is in place in terms of whether it's homelessness prevention or it's in terms of roundabout rent control data and so on. We need to make sure that that's the case because we can't put any more additional pressures on local authorities. But there are discussions ongoing in terms of that. And as I said, stage two, there will be an updated financial memorandum, which obviously would reflect that. But I don't know if any other colleagues want to mention around about that in terms of any around about resource discussions.
Just to say, similar to the homelessness prevention measures, we did engage with local authorities in terms of costings. So we asked all the local authorities to provide us with information in relation to the rent control measures. And we took cognizance of the information that was provided from the local authorities who responded in developing our estimates. But we did acknowledge in the financial memo that there was a level of uncertainty. It's a locally based assessment process. It will be staged. It will require local authorities to make decisions about how much assessment they want to do based on what they understand about their area. So that was brought forward in the financial memo, but they did take account of information that local authorities fed in.
Okay, thanks very much. And one final question. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee expressed concerns about a number of different powers under the bill, suggesting that there's a need for more detail on the face of the bill. I'd be interested to hear your response to these concerns and how you'd consider putting more detail on the face of the bill with a view to giving tenants, landlords and investors greater certainty.
Yeah, I think we've kind of touched on that. One of the key things, I think, for me was the flexibility around about that. One, around about the individual circumstances on each of the local authorities, and I think that's important in terms of that. In terms of looking at the possible amendments or changes to the bill, I think that's given us the flexibility at this stage to discuss it with them in terms of what's required. And it comes back to the balance around about, you know, protecting, and again, coming back to the whole purpose, you know, around about the rent controls, it's making sure that we're protecting people who need the rent controls in place. It's making sure it's not deterring investment in terms of that as well. So it's about trying to strike that particular balance, and obviously being reflective of individual local authority or wider regional impacts at that particular time. So that was a reason around about that, and I said happy to come back when and these are come in terms of the stage two amendments or changes that are made in the bill then to discuss that. But it was around about just giving more flexibility and trying to be as flexible to make sure it's not a one-size-fits-all answer to rent controls.
Okay. Thanks very much. And I said that was the last, but Miles Briggs would like to come in with a very brief supplementary.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Given that there is this opportunity to look at opening up the bill for more amendments, just wondered whether or not the Minister had considered work around void properties and potential different models to bring these back. We have a conversation almost on a weekly basis with regards to homelessness situation in Edinburgh, the 3,000 empty properties the council have, but just wondered whether or not there is an opportunity to look at that differently. I know there's significant issues, for example, in the performance of utility companies bringing these properties back, as well as the investment the council are asking for to be able to look at some of the modernisation needs of these properties. But just wondered if there is an opportunity, given this is a housing bill with very little housing necessarily in it, to actually see about a different model or some work which potentially could be included at this stage.
And I'll try and be brief, Convener. There's a couple of things. One, obviously, there was funding announced last week, which Edinburgh will significantly benefit from in terms of us. We've been working with Edinburgh in terms of the voids practices in terms of what they need to do, and I think they're making progress in terms of that, so we've tried to help them in terms of this. Also, there's a round table coming up with utility companies that was raised when a meeting with housing conveners talking about the issue around about utility companies. There's a round table coming up with utility companies and local authorities about how we can improve the practice around about that, and utility companies need to be doing more and working quicker with us in terms of that. So that work's already undergoing in terms of that as well. There's also, in terms of the Housing Investment Task Force, that's looking at different funding models around about, you know, accommodation and so on as well. So happy to pick that up in the discussions that we've got planned in terms of that. If there's anything you think we could consider as an amendment, happy to discuss that. But there's already other things kind of going on in trying to support that, because the voids issue, as you recognise, is incredibly important in Edinburgh specifically. But happy to take that offline with you.
Great. Thanks. Thanks, Karine.
Thanks very much. Well, thank you so much for a good morning. I think it's been really useful to get into some of the detail, and we'll look forward to seeing the amendments, and we will consider our approach to our report, given that there are going to be some amendments that we won't necessarily have been able to scrutinise. Thanks so much. And as that was the final public item on our agenda today, I now close the public part of the meeting.